As I said, it is an honor to be here. It's an honor to, on a daily basis, be at an organization that wants to look at the enduring impact of World War I and to honor those sacrifices. And it is an honor to be here with all of the women that you see in our panel. First in my lineup, and I don't know how this is showing up for each of you, is Elsie Shemin-Roth. She attended Syracuse University, Utica. She is a frequent speaker for veterans groups and students about the impact of anti-Semitism and discrimination, and she is joining us from St. Louis, Missouri. Also joining us is Joan Barkley Wells, who attended the University of Missouri Kansas City Conservatory of Music. She has been past president of both the Symphony's Women's Association and Women's City Club, along with a lot of other philanthropic organizations in and around the city that she is joining us from, Kansas City. She is also a former trustee of the National World War I Museum and Memorial. And Cathy Ehlers Metcalf, who has 34 years of experience in education, including time at the California State University in Fullerton, California, where she is also, that is also her alma mater. She is now the Executive Director of Education with the Congressional Medal of Honor Society. This means that we are, I get to sit on a panel with the Executive Director of Education at the Congressional Medal of Honor Society and two women whose fathers were recipients of the Congressional Medal of Honor from World War I. And truly, it's been a wonderful opportunity to get to know you all and to provide this stage for you all to talk about your fathers and to talk about your life experiences as well, and to bring light to an aspect of World War I that we really don't get the opportunity to talk about very often. Thank you all so very, very much. So Cathy, the first question is actually gonna be for you. Today is National Medal of Honor Day. What does that mean?
Thank you so much, Laura. Today is the day that we commemorate the awarding of the very first Medal of Honor, which was on March 25th, 1863, by President Lincoln. And we now recognize all 3,507 recipients of the Medal of Honor. There has been, in the history of the country, 3,526 medals awarded. 19 of them were double medals, mostly from World War I. And the great bulk of the medals were from the Civil War, when the Medal of Honor was the only medal we had. But today we look at commemorating all the sacrifices made by Medal of Honor recipients and those they served with from all conflicts. So it's a privilege to be here. Thank you. I'm looking forward to hearing from Elsie and Joan.
To receive the National Medal of Honor, one of the very first things that needs to occur is that you need to join the military. Joan, can you tell us a little bit about your dad and explain why he joined the military back when he did?
Well, he tried to join the military after the, can you hear me? Can you hear me?
Yes.
Absolutely. You sound great.
All right. Well, as I said, he tried to join the military after the declaration of war by President Wilson and the U.S. Congress. They were so incensed by the Zimmerman report from Germany to their agency in Mexico, that if the Mexican government helped them, they would give to them the southwestern part of the United States from Texas to California. And when that decoding of this Western Union letter, shall we say, it was leaked to the press, and that caused a major upheaval, and Congress voted to declare war on Germany and its allies. Now, my dad got a letter from Uncle Sam wants you, and that was from his local draft board. He went in as soon as possible, and well, physically he was in great shape. When they tested him on speech, he stuttered terribly, so he failed. He went back another time. He wasn't going to give up, and he thought, well, maybe if he would try to speak slowly and not let him rattle him. Well, he passed physical, and the speech was still, it was a little strange, I guess. And anyway, a couple of the draft board members went into a back room, and he could hear one man in a loud voice say, "We want fighting men, not orators." So he got in, and he was sent to Camp Funston, Kansas. That's where the World War I draftees in this area were sent. So that's how he got in.
And your dad was from the Kansas City area?
He was from, Johnson County, Missouri. He was born in Henry County, and the PO was Blairstown. And he was one of eight children, five girls, and he was the second son. And there were two parents and a Kentucky grandfather who also stayed with him for a while. And John, to help supplement the family table, shall we say, went out hunting at an early age, say 8 years old, 10 years old, and went fishing, bring back fish. Well, I was going to say possum, but that's another story. No possum, but rabbits and squirrels, ducks, geese, quail. Anyway, he helped supply the family table. And of course, that would be maybe 10 people, three squares a day, as they used to say. And then sometime a farmer would drop by and they'd invite him to lunch or whatever.
Yeah.
And then of course they had hired help if they had to feed. But he went to a one-room school, Scaly Bark, on Scaly Bark Creek. He then went to Holden, Missouri High School and took classes at the college at Warrensburg. And he stuttered, but they allowed him to write essays. And that's how he got through school.
There you go. Now, that is how your dad and why your dad kind of chose to go into the military and where he was. Elsie, can you tell us about where was your dad located and why did he join the military?
Quite an interesting story because the parents, my grandparents, all came from Russia, the entire Shemin family. There were four patriarchs, brothers. Three of them decided to come to America because they were suffering from the pogroms. The pogroms destroyed the Jewish communities in Russia and took their boys at age 12, made them stay in the army so that they never could come home again. So three of the four brothers came to America. My grandparents, the father of my of my father came to this country in 1890. They came to the Lower East Side for just 1 year. My father was born in the Lower East Side in New York City for 1 year. And at age one, they left because they discovered Bayonne, New Jersey, right over the river. And it was so much of a better life. My grandfather had an education. He was a surgical instrument maker in Russia, which meant that he could practice something to make a living when he came to America, which was quite unique because most immigrants that came really didn't have much to practice or much of an education. So they settled in Bayonne, and that's where my father lived. But we were directly hurt by the pogroms. A member of our family was taken, he was age two, and thrown out of a window. The child never recovered. And in a visit that I made to my grandfather at age eight or nine with my father, I heard terrible screaming, and it so frightened me, and it still does. And I asked, what is going on? And they told me the story. This baby now is a grown person and never recovered. And all he could do was cry for his life. There were no mental institutions or any kind of support system for the immigrants that came through that had mental problems. So they made a life, a beautiful life in Bayonne. My father was such an American. He played baseball. He was a real fine athlete. But when the war came, he saw very early on that he wanted to go. He was in high school. He was 16 years old. And he couldn't understand why our country wasn't in there doing something because of what he and his family directly experienced. And by the way, the fourth brother that remained with his family were all destroyed, murdered in the Holocaust. So the three brothers that were here had an excellent life. And my father wanted to pay back. That was so important, to pay back our country for the gift of being able to live and have raise a family and not have to have such terrible fear worrying you all the time. So, and of course, he through some grants, he was able to get himself educated. Up until the time he was in his 30s, he remained in Bayonne as a forester. That's the reason.
Now, Cathy, your dad also joined the military, but joined a little bit later. Could you tell his story?
Yes, my dad was a Depression era kid. His father was a Kansas farmer and had just finally invested in his own farm in 1929. And of course, like so many people at that time, ended up losing everything. And so the family struggled as itinerant farmers for the time my dad was growing up. My dad was born in 1921. And so in 1940, when there were still a few jobs to be had, he and his oldest brother decided to join the service. And when his older brother decided to go, he said, if you're going, I'm going. And off they went together to fight in World War II, and they served throughout the war.
Now, being that it is National Medal of Honor Day, at the National World War I Museum and Memorial, we really are honored to have Joan's father. His name is John Lewis Barkley. We are honored to have his Medal of Honor in our main gallery on the west side. Joan, could you tell us a bit more about how he and the events that led to his receiving the Congressional Medal of Honor?
Well, he was went to reconnaissance school in France, and one of his assignments was on Hill 253, and he was observing, and he saw some Germans coming in to an area called the Bois-Cunel, out of Cunel, France. And he wondered, well, where are the reconnaissance men? Because here he was there by himself. And he thought, well, now what to do? The story of his actions and his inventiveness and his stick-to-itiveness, I guess you'd say, and seizing up the situation appears in the publication Scarlet Fields, which is at the Liberty Memorial. But his the action took place on October 7th, 1918. And it, I could read to you, read at you, the official citation. And when you read that and see what's written in the book, the citation to me is just stilted. But anyway, it says, PFC Barkley, who was stationed in an observation post half a kilometer from the German line on his own initiative, repaired a captured enemy machine gun and mounted it in a disabled French tank near his post. Shortly afterwards, when the enemy launched a counterattack against our forces, PFC Barkley got into the tank, waited under hostile barrage until the enemy line was abreast of him, and then opened fire, completely breaking up the counterattack and killing and wounding a large number of the enemy. 5 minutes later, an enemy 77 millimeter gun opened fire point blank on the tank. One shell struck the drive wheel of the tank, but the soldier nevertheless remained in the tank, and after the barrage ceased, broke up a second enemy counterattack, nearby enabling our forces to gain and hold Hill 25. And in some references, it's called Hill 253. And the Medal of Honor was presented to him at Andernach, Germany. This was 1919. I think it was spring 1919. And they, before 90,000 troops, that seems horrendous, 90,000. But there was an airfield out away from the town of Andernach. And he received the medal from General John J. Pershing, another Missourian. And somehow he stuck something into my dad's chest, part of the medal, and went on. And the aide following up said, here, I'll fix that, which he did. The man was a major at the time, and his name was later he became General Douglas MacArthur. So that's it.
So you're saying that General John J. Pershing literally pinned it to his chest, and it was Douglas MacArthur who fixed it.
Yes, took it out of his skin.
that is quite a ceremony and an awarding of that Medal of Honor. Now, in later eras, the awarding of the Medal of Honor wouldn't necessarily occur on a battlefield or while people were still, as you can see, and this is the This is a image from our collection of the newspaper that actually goes through and talks about that day from those who saw it themselves. That is not necessarily how that occurs in later years. There's a wonderful picture of Barkley by artist Howard Chandler Christie with the medal, mm-hmm. as well as others. Cathy, could you tell us a little bit more about that history of how people end up, how these are now awarded after World War I?
Absolutely, I'd be delighted to. Just a little background for those of you who are watching and may not be terribly familiar with the Medal of Honor. The Medal of Honor is the highest military award that this country gives to servicemen and or women. And it is generally given for conspicuous gallantry and intrepidity at the risk of one's life above and beyond the call of duty. Those are the phrases that you hear most commonly. The thing that differentiates this medal from most of the others is that those who are awarded it are generally submitted for it by the people they were fighting alongside, as opposed to being put in for it by a commanding officer who may not have been on the battlefield with them. And awardees are referred to as recipients rather than winners. They will tell you it was not a contest and this is not something you set out to win, because it generally reflects the worst day of your life. The medal was signed into law in 1861. And what is really interesting about your panel tonight, Laura, is that from 1861 until right before World War II, or during World War I, the medal was pretty much the only medal that we had. We started this country with an idea that we would break from the tradition of lots of chest decoration that was so common in Europe. And so we had only the Purple Heart until we had the Medal of Honor. So when the Medal of Honor was begun, it was a one size fits all medal. And that's why there are almost 2,500 of them from the Civil War, because it was given for everything. Almost 1,000 of those were rescinded later, over 900, because some of them were given to entire units rather than to individuals. And during World War I, 1917 or so, the guidelines for the Medal of Honor were finally codified, and it was decided that it would be for outstanding action above and beyond the call of duty, something for which the military or the country would not have demanded that the serviceman do, and something for which he would not have been reprimanded had he chosen not to do. So it really set the Medal of Honor apart from the others. Currently, there have been a total of 3,507 I mentioned earlier, and there are currently only 69 surviving Medal of Honor recipients at this point. The majority of them historically from World War II forward, more than half were presented posthumously, meaning that the action for which they were presented resulted in the death of the person who was awarded the medal later. Now, I will say that the Medal of Honor history also parallels the history of this country. And we always try hard, but we have not always been perfect. And so if you go back a ways, you will see that there have been upgrades of medals. Generally, there is a two-year moratorium on a Medal of Honor. So from the time of the action until the time that the medal is awarded, it's supposed to be 2 years, but they make exceptions when, for instance, there were some from Vietnam where the paperwork was lost. And there have been others historically where there were cases of prejudice. And the best example on a large scale of that was the 442nd in World War II, the Japanese American contingent that was the most highly decorated unit in the history of the United States. And they had no medals of honor. They had only Distinguished Service Crosses and Silver Stars. So in contemporary times, about the time of President Carter forward, we've started going back and reviewing. And in fact, most of the War on Terror medals have been through reviews, because it became very apparent when we were 15 years into this war, that not a single young man had been awarded a Medal of Honor. And so they started looking more closely and doing reviews and trying to right the wrongs. And I will, I think, probably leave it there because we'll want to roll into Elsie's story, and I don't want to take any more time.
That's perfect. Thank you so much for giving that context. Elsie, yes. Let's talk about your dad and the actions that led to his receiving of the Medal of Honor.
Yes. In fact, Kathy's little visit in explaining the Medal of Honor is very much my father's story. Sergeant William Shemin, 47th Infantry, Company G, a rifleman in the 4th Infantry Division. His Medal of Honor action happened on the Vale River in the little village of Bezoche, which was right near it, on August 7th, 8th, 9th, and 10th, 1918. Sergeant Shemin was 19 years old at the time, lied about his age, told his father that if he didn't come with him to the recruiting station and say he was 21, he would never come home again. And he meant it. His father came and said he was 21, but he was 19. Company G consisted of two platoons, each with approximately 30 men. Sergeant Shemin commanded one of those platoons because all officers and non-commissioned men higher in rank than my father had been killed or wounded. He was next in line. Company G platoons had to cross the Vale River, which is much like the Missouri River here, to access the village of Bezoche, which was high on a hill. They crossed in the face of German machine gun, rifle, artillery fire from the tops of buildings in Bezoche, looking down. The Americans were perfect targets below in that river. They were also gas bullets dropped from low-flying planes as they crossed the river. Platoon struggled to cross by holding on to floating trees, parts of destroyed footbridges across the river, swimming, trying to wade, some drowned, all trying to avoid the deadly constant fire from above. In crossing, many gas masks were destroyed by getting soaked. The enemy then threw over 4,000 shells, of which 1/3 were gas. The enemy used Minenwerfers. They were like a small cannon that two men could carry. They were horrifically accurate. They were originally very large, like a big cannon, and pulled by a rail or 6 horses. They did Herculean damage. Shemin led his men ashore and organized them to start climbing the rock mountain, as he just received orders to take Bezoche at all costs. Sergeant Jim Pritchard, Shemin's best friend, who was also in his platoon, was ordered to destroy a German machine gun position with two other men. As they proceeded, the two men were instantly killed, and Pritchard was badly wounded in the shoulder and was bleeding profusely. Shemin had to decide to watch Jim die or rescue him in the middle of a field with no cover. The sun was shining, heavy fire coming from all sides, and two of his men lying there dead. He had to go, listen to this, 150 yards to get Jim. That's 150 yards, the length of a football field, 2 times, there and back. His chance for survival were minuscule. Without hesitation, he leaped into action, carried Jim to safety, and evacuated him to a medic. Jim was over 6 feet tall and weighed 200 pounds. Leading his men into Bezoche, occupied by the enemy was brutal hand-to-hand and building-to-building combat. During this action, he was able to recover two more men in a field of heavy fire where he and the men that he was going to rescue were the only targets the Germans targeted. Both men were wounded, but carried by some amazing miracle to safety by Sergeant Shemin. It was an enemy counterstrike that left Shemin's platoon exposed and vulnerable with no help coming. Shemin calmly reorganized his men out of Bezosh for a withdrawal, safely leading them down the mountain and across the Vail River again. At some point during the final action, Shemin was shot in the head with a bullet deflecting off the buckle of his helmet, lessening its speed and force. It lodged behind his ear, in his head, near his brain. The doctor said, had that buckle not been there, he would have been killed instantly. He refused medical help until his platoon was safely withdrawn. The next day, he was found unconscious and evacuated to a hospital where he spent 6 weeks recovering. On his right side, his hearing was permanently damaged. 2 days after his discharge from the hospital on September 25th, he rejoined his unit in the bloodiest battle of all the war, the Meuse-Argonne. He remained at the front fighting 47 days until the armistice on November 11th was signed. He then volunteered to stay on with the Army of Occupation in Bruck, Germany, until discharged August 2nd, 1919. His men, as Cathy said, his men wanted to recommend him for the Medal of Honor. They were told that no Jew would receive our nation's highest military award. 6 members of his platoon, 3 officers and 3 sergeants, then recommended my father for the Distinguished Service Cross, our nation's second highest military award. This is what they said in their written recommendation, and I'm quoting. Sergeant Shemin was cool, calm, intelligent, and utterly fearless. He was a big factor in maintaining splendid morale and tactical efficiency of his platoon. He did receive the Distinguished Service Cross. But when asked what he thought about being denied the Medal of Honor, this is what he said, and I'm quoting him. War is not about medals. I love my country. I love my men. That's all that counts. He never mentioned it again and was always so proud to have received the Distinguished Service Cross. However, there is a twist here. 97 years later, on June 2nd, 2015, after a review that started in 2001 and took 14 years, President Barack Obama, in the elegant East Room of the White House, posthumously awarded the Medal of Honor Sergeant William Shemin, a rifleman in the 4th Infantry Division. And please forgive me if I start to cry, because I never get through this without these tears in my eyes. That's the story.
And Elsie, we've also had the honor of being able to share this award within the museum and memorial as well, when it was on exhibition with For Liberty, the American Jewish Experience in World War I.
Yes, yes.
Now, I would like, Yep, that's it.
Okay.
Yep.
This is the beautiful leather container that the Medal of Honor. Am I doing this okay?
You are. You're doing it great.
There it is.
It's great.
Okay. Is everybody ready? You ready? Wow.
There you go. Hold it up a little bit higher. There you go.
Let me get my hand out of the way.
Now,
everyone has a story, a brilliant, brilliant story. And I have to say, their families have a story, a brilliant, brilliant story, too. You can't live with a Medal of Honor recipient without having a story of what this was like. Okay.
And perfect. And talking about stories, and Cathy, you've been so gracious as well. And we are going to give you less time than we are providing for others. But your father also has a story. Would you be willing to just very briefly let people know about that story or where they could find out some more about his story?
Absolutely. My father was awarded the Medal of Honor for actions June 9th and 10th of 1944 near Gouville, France. He had fought through the war with his oldest brother. They landed together in North Africa with the 1st Infantry. They landed in Sicily. From Thanksgiving of 1941 until December of 1944, he never went home. He was going from action to action. And they were separated before they went into the Normandy invasion. My father had his own platoon at that point and was at 24, a seasoned soldier. And he was fortunate enough to get his entire platoon over the beach without a casualty. And then he was wounded for the first time during his Medal of Honor action. He would find out in July of 1944 that his brother had been killed on the landing. And so that's my dad's story. Thank you for letting me share it.
Thank you. And if I am not mistaken, he has also been a big supporter of the National World War II Museum.
Yes.
And you can find out more information there, as well as I believe that he is in a documentary on World War II. Is that correct?
Yes, thank you. He's actually been featured in several documentaries, and he was one of the soldiers. He and his brother's story were featured between the various town stories in the documentary Ken Burns the War. So there's that. The National World War II Museum in New Orleans is a phenomenal representation, a parallel to the World War I Museum in Kansas City, but of World War II. And then all three of these gentlemen their stories are on the Medal of Honor Society's website at CMOHS, or Congressional Medal of Honor Society, CMOHS.org. Do you want me to go ahead with this, Laura?
Yes, that's spectacular. We're gonna type that into the chat as well. Now, the Congressional Medal of Honor Society, they have and there is a new character education program that has been put out online, but there are character traits and characteristics that were chosen by the Medal of Honor recipients themselves. Cathy, could you tell us more about that?
Absolutely. A few years ago, actually around 2007, before we started getting the Medal of Honor recipients from the War on Terror, the surviving ones, the numbers of Medal of Honor recipients were dwindling rapidly. And the recipients realized that as a group, they wanted to do something to perpetuate their legacy. And as a group, they decided that education for the young people in this country was what they wanted. They did not want the sacrifices that they and their fellow service people had made to go disrespected, to be forgotten. So they decided on these six character values that you see on the screen: patriotism, citizenship, integrity, courage, sacrifice, and commitment. And they asked a group of teachers to build lessons around these, featuring stories of Medal of Honor recipients. So this character program, now known as the Medal of Honor Character Development Program is joins many other fine character programs in this country, but it is one of the very few that is filled with concrete examples of these values in action. And that is what I think what Elsie was referring to when she says that if you have lived with, spent much time around a Medal of Honor recipient, you become very familiar with these values that they inherently share.
And now I've asked both Elsie and Joan to just choose one of those, because people are more than their moments in war. There's so much more to individuals. So Elsie, this time we'll start with you. Could you tell us a bit about how your father, outside of World War I, modeled one of those values?
Indeed, I will, Laura, and I'm sure that my two lovely ladies here would agree that every one of those attributes on the list, yes, are held by Medal of Honor recipients, all of them. Mine, I will pick courage, and I'll be very brief, and that is what just happened in the 30s, and I happened to be there at the time. When this happened, I was only 8 years old. Right next door to where we lived on our farm was a beer garden. It was called Reinlinger's Beer Garden, and you could Google it, and it's right there. And guess who came in the 30s? The American German Bund came for a meeting spouting their terrible anti-Semitism, their anti-Americanism, and they were building to bring Hitler over here. The war was starting in Europe. And as they were all German, and they were all Americans, and there were a lot of them. My father went over to hear this because he had heard about them just right next door. And he was horrified. They had planned to come back the following week with the terrible anti-Semitism, especially blaming Jews for everything. So we're coming back the next weekend to do this again. During the week, my father called all of his World War I buddies together and said, we're gonna go and show them a thing or two. So he went with about 15 of his World War I buddies, and it was horrific. They beat them to a pulp. My father came home, his whole head was beaten in and his whole body was bloody and his clothes were a mess. And my mom, poor mom, said to him, my God, William, what happened? And he looked at her and he smiled and he said, you should see what they look like. They never came back again. And that was the beginning, because of the anti-Semitism that they were spewing throughout the United States. My father organized the first Jewish war veterans group in the Bronx, which is where our farm, believe it or not, a farm was in the Bronx. So to take care of terrible things like this. And that was the main reason why the Jewish War Veterans Post 212 was created. My father was the first commander. And this was a lot of courage to just go and do what he did.
Joan, your dad also shared many of these values. Would you like to share another story?
Yes, reading the list. Actually, he had probably 90% of the values, but I chose citizenship because, after World War I, this was in the 20s, he was quite often asked to appear in parades and that type of thing. Well, he was really kind of a shy person, but I think he thought that he was representing his fellow doughboys that couldn't come to the meetings or were permanently in Europe. And that way, he okay, he was at the dedication of the first, well, the Liberty Memorial, 1926. And I'm probably getting the wrong artist, but Daniel McMorris painted a mural, and it's at the Liberty Memorial of the famous people and Kansas City people who were guests up in kind of the viewing stands to see this dedication. If you look closely, way up there is my dad, kind of in a corner, but he made it to the picture. Painting. He was a trustee for the Liberty Memorial, and I'm not certain when they started the trusteeship. But anyway, I would say 1930, maybe something like that. And he was trustee until his death in 1965. But like I said, he loved to go to these parades, and he dragged, well, he escorted my mother and me to these parades. Well, I like to go, but it always seemed it was the coldest day of the year. And as a little girl, I wore probably little corduroy slacks with a dress over it, very chic, you know. Anyway, I even met President Harry Truman, shook hands with him, and various other people. He became associated with the Medal of Honor Society, I would say, in the mid-50s. And the first meeting was at Lakeland, Florida, and Tampa. And they dedicated a bridge to a Medal of Honor recipient down in that area. Other places, very interesting, was the dedication of the Medal of Honor Grove in Valley Forge. That was a highlight. And got to go, he said, you'll learn more going to these meetings or going to these programs more than you'll learn in college. So, and he was right, because met people that are part of history now. Everything, but in 1936, he married my mother, who lived in Johnson County, Kansas, and he was from Johnson County, Missouri, but they were 70 miles apart. And they became acquainted through relatives who intermarried. And he used to say that he went from a Missouri backwoodsman to a Johnson County, Kansas dairy farmer. And that was a jump. So anyway, he became interested in various civic groups in Johnson County, Kansas. One of them was the Sartoma Club, which was a men's civic group. And about 1953, the Kansas legislature was backing the development, just starting out, of a county park system. Well, the Sartoma Club got it going and got the funds for it. And my dad was on a committee, and then it got down to a committee of one. And he worked, volunteered 9 hours a day or 12, depending. And anyway, he was the first Johnson County, Kansas park superintendent. Now it's called executive director. He was paid $350 a month, and I can assure you the pay now was much, much higher. But anyway, he thought that all children should not be on a tiny lot and expected to have a joyful life or really to learn anything. And he wished all children could have the life that he had growing up in rural Missouri and going out at night by himself and staying in the forest. And I guess you'd say communing with nature. but he meant it. And anyway, he was responsible for the development of two parks. One was a small 40-acre park, suburban area, Merriam, Kansas. Another was the development of the 1,250-acre Shawnee Mission Park with a huge man-made lake. And the road going across the dam has his name on it. There was a visitor center. It was a plaque dedicated to him. That was since torn down. And there has been, well, a redevelopment of the Shawnee Mission Park entryway. And in the center of this entryway, there is the John L. Barkley Center. And it will be dedicated to him April the 24th this year, 10 o'clock in the morning. And he was at one time called by a writer for the Kansas City Star, Mr. Johnson County Parks. It basically all started with him. And I'm sure he would be very surprised at how it's developed into 16 or 17 major parks. And there are a couple of more that are still in the works by the Johnson County Park District. And it's a gold medal district in the National Parks Associations. So it all started from a Missouri boy who wanted children to be able to go out and experience nature and develop their souls. That's what it's about.
And if you are in and around the greater Kansas City area, I think you do know just how spectacular the Johnson County Parks are. And we certainly, and I'll repeat Joan's invitation there, would love for you all to come out to take a look at some of the amazing things that the Johnson County Park is doing at the Shawnee Mission Park. They are unveiling a new pavilion with a new, dedication and information exhibit there. I know because we were glad to share some of that information with the Johnson County Museum. That's going to open up later next month. Mm-hmm. But all of you who are
also a trustee of the museum.
Yes. And we are really honored to be able to care for and share part of his story. Actually, part of this this book, Scarlet Fields, is actually a work that was re-edited. It was your dad's autobiography, re-edited by Stephen Trout. And if you are interested in it, you can find out more information and you can purchase it on our website. All proceeds actually go to the museum and memorial.
Mm-hmm. The first book that was compiled and that he wrote from notes that other people got together and edited it, and Cosmopolitan Book, Hearst Publications, published it. And they told him there'd be like 20,000 books published. Well, no, 3,500, 4,500. And the book sold for the whopping $2 a book, 1930. And he received a nickel in royalty for each book. So that was really a lot of money.
Now, we would love to, because we do have the experts on these individuals. We would really welcome any of the questions that you all in the audience might have. Please feel free to add those into the Q&A section of our Zoom conversation here. And while you do that, I would also encourage you, no matter where you are around the United States, you might take a look at the names of the individuals on the American Legion post and on the VFW post. As Elsie had mentioned before, each of these spaces, they have stories. Each of these individuals have stories, and they are named for individuals for a reason. And it is worth finding out those local stories. Also, and many of us have been doing so in this last year, if you enjoy your local parks, Much of this starts around the era of World War I as well. There are many avid outdoorsmen and women who wanted to be sure that it is a that it was something that would be passed down generation upon generation. So I would also encourage you to take a look at the names of the individuals associated with parks around you. You might find that you have some really important World War I stories that are incredibly moving attached to the names. And certainly you would find some of these phenomenal character traits as well. People who are forward thinking, who are for the next generation, who are courageous in how they choose to live on a daily basis, and that they continue to do so with integrity and want to pass that along with great commitment. Now, there we go. Joan, I think this is the image that you were talking about.
Yes.
And if you have the right opportunity to come to, you said on the right?
I think so, in the back.
Now, if you all have the opportunity to come to the Museum and Memorial, this mural is located in Memory Hall. We will actually be hosting an educational experience called War Remains starting in June. And you'll still have the opportunity to see this as well. You can find out more information about that on our website, theworldwar.org. Now, in March, correct me if I'm wrong, Cathy, but it was in March of this year that you all, that the Congressional Medal of Honor Society rolled out a new online character development set of teaching tools. Is that correct?
It's actually a teacher training program. We generally go to cities around the country and hold teacher training days, professional development days, free of charge to all teachers, where they will have the opportunity to try out the character development lessons and work with other teachers to talk about ways to implement the program into their classrooms. And fortunately, we were afforded a grant by the Arthur M. Blank Family Foundation that allowed us to develop this online training program. It kind of fell in line with the COVID shutdown. And so we were able to get that put together, and we launched it officially March 1st. So until we're back into full in-person trainings, that's an easy opportunity. You can go on anytime to the Medal of Honor Society website and log on there. We also do webinars. We archive them. So there are interviews with Medal of Honor recipients. There I had the privilege to interview Hal Fritz and have him talk a little about Medal of Honor Day just earlier this week. So thank you for this. Also, resources for teachers and an educator login. It's all free. Please take a look.
And that is something we really encourage you, if you are a teacher, if you know a teacher, to do. Cathy, can you give us that website again?
Yes, it's cmohs.org. So www.cmohs.org. If you have trouble remembering the letters, it's right there, Congressional Medal of Honor Society.
Exactly it. And here is a question. I'm going to end on another question that has just come in, and then I'll have one more question for each of you. So from Mike Venzo. Mike, thanks for placing this in here. He's a great program. Thank you all so much for sharing your stories and those of your brave and courageous fathers. Did any of your siblings or did any of your children or your grandchildren serve in the military? Is this a tradition that carried on within your own families of military service?
I answer that?
Yes.
Okay. In addition to my father, my brother was a major in the Korean War. Two sons, one Marine for 4 years, another one just finished 23 years as a commander in the Navy, a husband from World War II. I guess, is that enough?
That's great. That's great. Now, Joan, I don't think you are a veteran.
No, no. Now, my husband was in the Med Corps, Medical Corps. And years ago, I did threaten our two boys I'd send them to military school if they didn't shape up. Does that count?
And Cathy?
My brother served in the United States Army. And then after a tour in the regular Army, he went back into the National Guard and retired as a lieutenant colonel in the National Guard. And in fact, went into the service at Fort Riley, Kansas, as my dad did, so that he could be in the 1st Infantry Division where my dad had served. So none of the grandchildren has gone into the service yet. Our family is late bloomers, so they still have time to do that. And in fact, I have a nephew who is currently in ROTC at K-State University in Manhattan. And so he will be serving some time in the military. I don't know if he's going to make it a career or not, but he will be in for a while. My children all had health issues that kept them out of the service, unfortunately. But they had the privilege of growing up with their grandfather. Elsie mentioned, having a Medal of Honor recipient in the family, and they had phenomenal experiences. Both boys went to Normandy with their grandpa. My daughter has been to the White House with her grandpa. We took turns with that, and we went to I've taken them to some Medal of Honor conventions. So they have had phenomenal examples of role models in their lives because of this experience.
Absolutely. And what an honor to be able to pass down those character traits that are embodied within the Medal of Honor, but also in the best of our United States military and those who serve within it.
Laura, I would like to add right there that every Medal of Honor recipient that I have known will say that he wears that medal for the people he served with, for those whose stories didn't get told, for others who probably should have been awarded it, but there were either no eyewitnesses or it didn't get written up, for those who gave the ultimate sacrifice of their lives and the significant sacrifice of their limbs and their youth on the battlefields across the world for this country. And in that regard, it is a medal for the country as a whole.
Cathy, you have started into what was going to be the last question right there. I do have to do one more piece of business, and I realize if you're a teacher and you're here for a teacher certificate, please note that is your password right there, that you would be able to do that. And I am going to stop the sharing of this. If you needed more information about that, we'll include that later on. I want to give the last words to you all. Either yours or something that you would have heard either of your parents, because we know that it might have been the men who served within the military, but it is an entire family who is involved. And it is the mothers at home as well, while people are abroad and serving, who are also sacrificing and are also part of that whole family service. So is there a word of wisdom or something that you would want to be sure that you leave us with for those who are here in the room and for those on the recording later on? Some bit of wisdom, either of your own or that your mom or dad might generally have said on this type of topic.
Can I say something again, please?
Yes.
And I did say it before, but it is so important. So many of our Medal of Honor recipients had post-traumatic stress disorder. And living with that in a family growing up is sometimes very, very difficult. Mm-hmm. The family surrounding every Medal of Honor recipient are all so special, the support and the love that they give to their recipient. And they should always be honored right along with the Medal of Honor recipient. And there is one other thing. There, and Cathy, please correct me because I just read this. There is one woman recipient, and it was in World War I, and it was a nurse. She was the only Medal of Honor recipient in our history. We need more women now. We do.
Elsie, you're very close. It was Dr. Mary Walker, who was quite the feminist, and she was from the Civil War.
The Civil War, okay.
She died at the end of World War I, I believe 1919, at the age of 81
or 82. We need more pictures of her. I don't even have one picture of her anywhere.
Elsie, if you go to the medal, we just made a video about her. We have both a 3-minute video and an 11-minute video about Mary Walker.
Oh,
it is Women's History Month.
Thank
you're welcome. Let me point out that, by the way, the Medal of Honor, when it was codified as a combat medal. And because of that, and because we did not allow women in combat, you know, I mentioned earlier that the history of the medal parallels the history of the United States. Women were never in a position where they would likely have been in a situation to do something that would have merited them a Medal of Honor. Well, as of about 2 years ago, we now allow women in combat. And I would not be surprised to see women awarded. There have been some Silver Stars, and I wouldn't be surprised to see either some of those upgraded or perhaps women awarded the Medal of Honor. I would point out that many of the noble men that serve in our services, however, tend to have a little bit of a protective feeling about their female counterparts. And they, for the most part, would not wish that kind of combat on anyone, let alone women. And so that's why, you know, historically we tried to, we restricted women's liberties in an effort to protect them. And now they have that opportunity. So it could change, definitely could change, Elsie. We could see medals of honor awarded to women, In the meantime, the Medal of Honor Society recognizes citizen heroes as well with their Citizen Honors Program. You can read about it on the website, same website. And a number of women have been, civilian women have been awarded the Citizen Honors Medal for their either lifetime of service or for some heroic act in our citizenship. You know, teachers who have talked down students with guns and that sort of thing. So thank you for bringing that up, Elsie. That's a very important point.
Thank you for what you're doing.
It's a privilege.
Last words. Cathy, I'm going to start with you. Would there be a kind of a final word about the Medal of Honor that you would like to leave people with, or a piece of wisdom that your dad liked to say, or your mom?
Well, that would be another program. my dad, when you were asking earlier about which of the character values, one that's not up there is humility. And I would say that that's probably part of integrity. And he was extremely humble. And we were very fortunate. He did have PTS, but it did not manifest itself in a way that was terrible for any of us. But it's important for us to recognize that all people who serve in traumatic times are going to have some leftover traumatic stress, and to recognize that they need our constant support. And my dad and the many of the other Medal of Honor recipients did some videos that said, don't let the enemy win at home. Make sure that you get help if you need it. I would say that the thing he raised us by was, if you can't say something nice, don't say anything at all. And he always treated people the way he would want to be treated, with complete kindness and respect. And I still have people on a regular basis tell me how they treated him, how he treated them when they first met. And it is a privilege to carry on that legacy. Gives me something to always try to live up to.
Joan.
Oh. Well, I would say that he was rather quiet. My dad was rather quiet, unassuming, but he always was viewing a situation and how to I don't want to say get out of it, that isn't it, but what might happen to in given situations and try to diffuse things with humor.
Mm-hmm. There are other ways to, absolutely, other ways to diffuse it, other ways to diffuse things. Elsie, last word.
I'm so glad that the World War I Museum chose to do this. Jonathan Casey, who works there, a wonderful, wonderful researcher that helped me in coming up with so much information on my father, is the one that created this program. I'm just so grateful for this, to be able to get all of this out with a wonderful moderator like you that can pull it out of us. You know, we're not used to telling these stories, some of them very hard, most of them all heartfelt. And to have someone like Joan, I didn't think there was anybody like me, an old lady from World War I, and then right in Missouri. Yes. Can you believe it? World War I Museum is in Missouri. Joan's Missouri. I'm Missouri.
Kathy's dad grew up in Kansas. There's a good Midwest. There's something good in the Midwest happening here.
There is. And Kathy's just given us so much wonderful information. I'm going to be calling you at another time. They've named a school after my father, and I want the teachers to talk to you so that we can do some of the wonderful programming that the organization has. Thank you so much, Laura, for your help. It hasn't been easy for any of us to do this. I'm so grateful. Thank you.
It has been a delight to be able to share your stories, to share your thoughts and your reminiscences on your fathers and what their service to our nation means. And on this day, as we reflect back on the Medal of Honor, what that means, not only in the sacrifice and the patriotism of the individuals, but what it means for the nation. I could not have asked for been more honored to be sitting on a panel and being able to listen to your stories. Thank you so much. And thank you all for watching, whether that is live or recorded. And again, we would encourage you to go take a look at the www.cmohs.org. You can find out more about Mary Walker. You can find out more about character education traits and the online tools and webinars and a variety of programs that they have for you there. And of course, we would always welcome you to visit us at theworldwar.org and learn more about World War I, its enduring impact, and the incredible individuals who lived and shared their stories with us, that we get the opportunity to continue to share it with you. Thank you so very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Laura.
Thank you.